The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much fine gold. They are sweeter than honey from the comb. By them is your servant warned. In keeping them there is great reward. Who can discern his errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sin. May they not rule over me. Then will I be blameless, innocent of great transgressions. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Precious Lord, in the words of the psalmist, we come under your covering of blessing, enablement, anointing of your Spirit. Grant us wisdom, discernment, ability to understand truth that we might share it with others. Bless us now in this session. In Jesus' name, amen. I want you to turn with me to the first book of the New Testament. Before you all turn to Matthew, let me remind you that there's another way to look at the books and the order in which they were written. And most Bible scholars agree that the first book of the New Testament was the book of James, written by the pastor of the church at Jerusalem, the half-brother of our Lord, and just a wonderful epistle, and one that's very basic to understanding truth and walking in truth. And I want you to open to the third chapter, and we'll be looking at a few verses from there and then go on into chapter 4 in a few moments. I want you to take your notes now and turn to the C section. Before you all think that might be something to do with the birth of a new child, let me remind you it's just a portion of our notes. And it has to do with interfacing our enemies. We'll take a quick view of that today. And you have there at the beginning on C1 some notes that were prepared for Telos Ministry. With the Bill Gothard organization, and they actually have correspondence students who are taking some tests. On page C8, one of the most important little practical tools that you will learn in your whole life, I hope you will learn, because it's tremendously important material. You know, what we're doing is trying to put tools in your hands to use and to help others. And I learned this first one from a missionary many years ago. She was on the mission field, and she came down with a severe case of depression, and there was no one there to help her, no counselor, and she just turned to her Lord, who's a wonderful counselor, and asked him what she should do. And he laid on her heart that she should set aside one day a week on her day off when she would fast and pray. And every hour on the hour, she would pray this little prayer against any spirit of depression that the kingdom of darkness was putting on her. In the name of my Lord Jesus Christ and by the power of his blood, I pull down all deceptive powers of darkness, seeking to deceive and control me by this severe depression. I command these powers of darkness to cease their wicked work, and they must leave me and go where my Lord Jesus Christ sends them. Well, she did this for 3 weeks. And at the end of the 3 weeks, she was so remarkably relieved just doing it that one day a week on her day off. She thought if that worked so well for her, maybe she could use it to help her mother. And one of the things that triggered her own depression was her mother had had a breakdown, a reported breakdown here in the States. And so she started to pray the same way, fasting and praying every hour on the hour on her day off. And in no time at all, she got word that her mother was out of the hospital. Now, this has a tremendous broad field of usefulness. If you see somebody that you know, maybe your husband, your wife, some of your children, that may be under the control or the oppression of the evil one, there's no better tool that you can use. And in that symptom area, you can put as many things there as seem appropriate. The one at the bottom of this page is equally significant. It's not unusual for us to develop difficult relationships with people where we wonder how we can continue to relate to them. Could be your children, could be a friend, could be somebody in your church, or even your husband or wife. And just to recognize that spiritual authority is powerful. And when you use it, God honors it. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of his blood, I pull down all barriers and relationships between my husband and me that are being authored and built by Satan in the kingdom of darkness. I forbid that to happen. I will only accept relationships between my husband and me that are authored by the Holy Spirit in the will of God. And it's amazing how very difficult relationships can be quickly smoothed out and greatly assisted and helped by such an approach. Now you'll notice we have some notes on C9 by Dr. Victor Matthews, and you learn much about this from Dr. Warner. I'm not going to dwell on that. On page C10, you have a diagram. We're going to try to help you fill that out. You may want to take it out of your notebook and have it handy so you can fill in the places. Now, I want us to read from the book of James, starting with verse 13 of chapter 3. James asks a question. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. In other words, own up to the truth. And we've been hearing a lot about that, about not trying to hide the truth or accept the lie, but to believe the truth and own up to it. You'll notice that in verse 15, he says, such wisdom. And in this translation, that word wisdom is in quotes because it's not real wisdom. Such wisdom does not come from heaven. It's not from God. Where is it from? Well, here we're introduced to the world, the flesh, and the devil. First of all, he says, it's earthly, or it's of the world system. It's unspiritual. It's from natural man, or it is from the devil. So you have all three enemies introduced to us by the Apostle James. And then he goes on to say, where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. It opens up the door for great disaster in our personal lives, in our families, in whatever we're connected with. But there is another kind of wisdom. There's the wisdom that comes from heaven. What's it like? First of all, we learn that it's pure. The wisdom that's from God is morally clean, and it's peace-loving. The wisdom that God gives us is not quarrelsome. It's peace-loving, and it's considerate. This kind of wisdom thinks of others first. It's submissive. By the way, don't cringe at that word. You know, sometimes husbands and wives sort of struggle over that word because wives are exhorted to be submissive to their husband. But just before that, they're to be submissive to one another. So it simply means to have a servant's heart, which is all of God and all of grace. It's a beautiful thing. And then it's full of mercy. When somebody fails, you don't throw stones. And good fruit, it's impartial, it doesn't have favorites, it's sincere, it's genuine. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. Wow, that's what it's all about, friends. That's a beautiful, beautiful statement of the Spirit-filled, Christ-honoring, victorious life in the Lord Jesus. That's the kind of fruit that it produces. In the fourth chapter, he sort of changes the order. Back there in verse 15 of chapter 3, he put the world first. But now when he comes to chapter 4 and is going to deal with them, more specifically, he changes the order to where he talks about the flesh first. And I believe there's a biblical reason for that. In my understanding, the flesh is the worst enemy we have. And it's very, very close to us. It's a part of who we are. And it opens our lives to the world. It opens our lives to Satan's deceptions. And so it's not surprising that the Apostle James brings the flesh before us in the very first order of things. And this is an internal enemy. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? This is an internal problem that's right within us. And it's a very serious problem because it is internal. Notice some of the ways it expresses itself. You want something, but don't get it. Greed is one of the characteristics of the flesh. It's always wanting something for self. And of course, if that's your motive, you don't get it because it's not God's plan for the Christian. And notice it can become murderous at times. You kill and covet, but you cannot have what you want. You quarrel and fight. Quarrels and fights, almost without exception, are flowing out of the flesh. And the pride and haughtiness of the sinful self. Then he says, you do not have because you do not ask God. In other words, one of the first things to go when we fall into fleshliness is our prayer life. And we just kind of, we may pray at the table and kind of the little perfunctories of prayer, but the real passion of prayer sort of leaves our lives and we're not really hearing from God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You have an internal enemy. He's very powerful. The second enemy that we have is an external enemy. You'll notice he says, you adulterous people. Now, this is not a physical act of adultery. He's talking about spiritual adultery here, where you want to have friendship with the world and friendship with God, which never mixes. And he points out that friendship with the world is really hatred toward God. Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. And so the world is a powerful enemy. It's the external enemy. And there are two Greek words that are translated world in our English Bibles. One is the word ion, which has to do with philosophy. And that's a very powerful enemy that affects us because it has to do with what we're thinking and what we believe about the world system. And the cosmos is the organized structure. Both of these words are important to understand. That sort of puts pressure on us to conform to the values of the world. And then, of course, we have a third enemy that is the infernal enemy, and that's supernatural evil. But notice where James keeps our focus. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. How long has it been since you heard your pastor tell you that? That's a strange statement. But in this context, it has great meaning, because he's introducing us to our infernal enemy, the devil. And when we have unresolved sin in our lives, it's a deadly situation, because it means that we open ourselves to the activity of evil powers. And they begin to try to make us conform to their purposes and their control. And so we're trying to understand the seriousness of it. And you'll notice that closes this section with saying, humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. When God is in his proper place and our attitudes toward him is in its proper place, then we're wonderfully on our way to victory over the kingdom of darkness. And submitting ourselves to God, resisting the devil aggressively, coming near to God, and humbling ourselves before him has to do with our relationship to the Lord. But then this attitude of grieving, mourning, and wailing, and changing our laughter to mourning and our joy to gloom, just tells us how deadly serious it is and how we need to be very, very careful that we are resolving the sin issues in the way that God would have us to. Now, what are the basic things that I need to know about each of these enemies? Well, it's good to have a biblical definition of each one, and I need to know how each one of them is going to tempt me, and how I can distinguish one from the other. I need to know what God has given me to walk in freedom from the control and the rule of the enemy. And we can see the interfacing. I'm going to get up off this chair. Take up your bed and walk. Get rid of your chair. Take out your circle And we will try to look at that in a biblical way. How did God make you? He made you a person. And you have a physical part of you, a body. And you have two internal parts, if your view is trichotomy or tripartite view of man, which mine happens to be. Now, let me just assure you, not all of our teachers have a tripartite view. Some have a dichotomy view, just the two parts. And I just have always given them the privilege to be wrong. And I just go on teaching what I understand. But that's the way the Lord made us. Physical people with bodies, with real physical needs. And then we have a soul. That's the part of you where your personality resides. And that includes your intellect, your mind. It includes your volition, your will. And it includes your emotions. Those are tremendously important parts of being a person. And then God didn't make you just a person who has personality. He made you a person who has spirit. And that's the part of you that God gave us that was able to commune with the Lord and understand His will and do His will. So it's a very, very important understanding of who we are to see ourselves as the Bible pictures us. But the tragedy was that sin came in. God had said, in the day you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will surely die. Now, we know they didn't die physically. Their body didn't die. And the personality was still there. They could still think and will and feel. And most believe that the part that died was the spirit. Now, that doesn't mean it ceased to be. It was still a part of the person, but no longer capable of functioning because sin had come in and the spirit was not functioning as God intended. In fact, I believe that the function of the spirit was pretty much taken over by the soul. And with human wisdom and human will and human emotions and even satanic deceptions and world deceptions were a part of the confusion that came upon man. But then God had a plan to redeem us. And that's in John 3, verse 6, a tremendously important verse. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. And who's the first flesh in that statement? Well, it's your parents. The earthly parents God gave you. They gave you your flesh. They gave you your body. And they gave you your soul. And they gave you a spirit that needed to be reborn. And so the Holy Spirit came to live because that's what Jesus said, that flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, gives birth to spirit. And so the Spirit, Holy Spirit, came to reside within the human spirit, and we were brought to life. We call that regeneration. It's a wonderful work of grace by which God brought us to spiritual life. And so that's, by the way, I believe that part that came to new birth is as righteous the day you were saved as it's ever going to be. That God made you holy in His sight and righteous. And there's a part I remember when I used to have those sessions of walking and praying, how that sometimes when I'd get up early in the morning and go to the church and walk and pray, I'd have to admit, God, my flesh really didn't want to be here. I'd like to be back in bed, getting a few more minutes of sleep. But I know that there's a part of me that you've caused to be reborn, that just loves to be here, loves to fellowship with you. And I would just pray that somehow the Holy Spirit will energize my whole person by that wonderful work of your grace and mercy. And it's amazing how many times it just, that began the beginning of something really fresh and new in my whole person. So now let's think about where we live. We live in the world. And the world has different expressions. There's the world of education. And there's the world of entertainment. That's a powerful expression of the world. This is what begins to shape our thoughts and our philosophy and our attitudes according to the standards of the world, by the world of education. And of course, there's so much in that realm that has to do with great affront toward God. Think of evolution and some of the moral standards that are a part of the world of education. And then there's the world of politics. My, we're hearing a lot about that as we're moving toward our presidential election, that the world of politics is just constantly in the headlines in the news that we read. There's the world of finance. There's the world of religion. That's powerful. And of course, right now we're in tremendous religious worldly conflict with the whole Islamic sort of extremism that's really the chief battle in the world today. And then there's the world of advertising. And we could add so many to this, but I hope it gives you a picture that through the world's philosophy, through its organized system, there's this constant pressure, constant structure, and effort to press you into its mold. And that's a very important part of the battle we're in. It's not just a battle with the devil. It's not even just a battle with our flesh, but the whole world environment in which we live is a tremendous battle point. Now, we have to move from just the world and the flesh to consider the infernal kingdom. And you'll notice we have done this with a series of shaky lines. Now, just a few things to remind you about that. You'll notice that the kingdom of darkness has a part of the world system. In fact, Satan is called the god of this world, the god of this age. And he has very much to do with what goes on in world affairs. And he's always affecting it. For example, let's just think of the world of education again. What in the world of education is probably the biggest lie that has ever been foisted upon humanity? Those of us who know biblical truth quickly know what that is. It's the lie of evolution. That it all just happened, that God did not really create it, that it was a part of the world just all happened. And then, of course, also from education, many times we get moral values that are not based upon spiritual values or spiritual truth at all. So it's an infernal kingdom. And that battle is very, very real. And we need to recognize the seriousness of it, and that we're locked into that battle, and we're a part of it. Well, we're going to move on to the flesh, but perhaps you have some questions you'd like to ask. The problem of the flesh. What is my flesh? I worked on this over a period of probably several months of study, trying to define what the Bible is talking about when it describes our flesh. In fact, I had a class that I was teaching. I was pastor at that time, and at times I would teach classes, and I challenged them to work with me on it, to try to define what this thing the Bible calls flesh is really referring to. And this is the biblical insight that I wrote into my own understanding, and I hope maybe it'll be helpful to you. This is on page C22. What is my flesh? Our flesh describes an internal part of my very person. It's a part of who you are. Where did it come from? That I inherited from the fall. What's it like? It's totally wicked and depraved. It can never be reformed or improved. Why is that? Because it flows out from God's judgment upon the sin of the fall. Now, in simple, not very profound theological terms, in my understanding, that sort of describes what we're talking about when we talk about this very human problem that all of us deal with. It's a part of who we really are, and we understand that it's a part of our very person. It's inherited, it's internal, it can never be reformed or improved. I can remember when I was dealing with this as a younger pastor, I was praying with a group of pastors, and my very good friend, Lester, who's now with the Lord, he was an older man, and yet we kind of liked each other. I was in my early 30s, and he was in his 60s, but we just sort of meshed, you know, how you sort of do sometimes with certain personalities, and so we were very good friends. And I thought about Lester. He pastored a rather large church, and every time I heard him preach, it was always powerful and very biblical. And I thought of him as probably the finest Christian that I had ever met. Well, we were praying with this group of pastors, and I heard Lester pray, "Lord, keep me from being a wicked old man." Wow, did that hit me. Well, we were good enough friends that when we were alone, I asked him, "Lester, what did you mean by that?" And he just kind of laughed at me, and he said, "Well, Mark, when I was your age, I was quite sure that after I had walked with the Lord as many years as I have, that I wouldn't be troubled with some of the problems that I had with fleshly temptations." But he said, "Even though I grant you I've learned a little better how to handle them, that they're still there." Well, after having lived some 40 more years, I'd say, Lester, you were right on. You never come to the place in this life where the flesh is not something you have to deal with. It's there. And we need to constantly be aware of that and understand it. Now, how does my flesh tempt me to sin? Well, there are a number of important passages that deal with that, and we don't have time to go deeply into all of these, but one of my favorites, that one in Colossians chapter 3, that speaks about the fleshliness of man and the problem that we have with our flesh. So turn to Colossians chapter 3 quickly. And you'll notice that Paul begins with a rather straightforward admonition to us. And I call these first verses in chapter 3 the presentations of the absolutes of grace for those of us who are Christians. Since then you've been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Now that's a pretty straightforward admonition for all of us. We have been raised with Christ. When did that happen? Now most of you would probably tell me about when you received the Lord. And that's not a wrong answer, because that's when it came into your experience. But what is it really talking about? It's talking about something different from your receiving the Lord. It's talking about the actual resurrection of Christ. You see, you're united with the Lord Jesus in all of his person and work. And you are one with him. And his resurrection is your resurrection. Notice that he goes on and speaks about the second absolute of grace. For you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. That's one of the most profound statements in the Bible. You died to the penalty and the power of sin through the work of Christ. When did that take place? At the cross of the Lord Jesus. His death was your death. He paid the penalty totally. And your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, there's the third absolute of grace. This is yet future. The first two are historic, the resurrection and the death of Christ. This one is future. It hasn't happened yet. But it's just as sure as the other two, that when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. There's coming the day where when Christ appears, you will enter into the fullness of your salvation. Already your standing is totally righteous, but when he appears in the moment in the twinkling of an eye, that body that may have disappeared in ashes or in deterioration in the grave will suddenly come to life. And you will appear with him in glory. You know, it's so beautiful to realize that you are so united with the Lord Jesus that he will not even come again without you. I remember the first time I heard myself pray that. I just burst into tears because the truth of it just flooded my whole soul and spirit that I am so united with Christ, he's not going to come again unless I'm with him. Now he starts to come and you're caught up to meet him in the air, and in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, you're changed. So these tremendous absolutes of grace are important. And therefore, we are to put to death whatever belongs to our earthly nature or our fleshly nature. Now, I have an engineer's mind, and whenever I read that, I say, how do I do that, Lord? And that's pretty important to ask. And then he names some of the sins of the flesh. Sexual immorality. Impurity, lust, sexual sin seems to always have its foundation in the flesh. It's a part of the way the flesh seeks to draw us into its control. And then he talks about greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. And then he reminds us, you used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. But now that you're born again Christian, you must rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you've taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge in the image of its creator. And so it's tremendously important to understand how to do that. How do you deal with your flesh? And it's very important to understand how it tempts you. We learned some of them. Now turn back to the book of Galatians, because I think Galatians 5 is probably one of the most insightful passages in the Word of God on how to deal with your flesh. You'll notice that the first verse starts out, "It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then. Do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery." Don't get drawn back into the bondage of letting your flesh rule you and control you. Notice verse 13, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. The entire law is summed up in a single command: love your neighbor as yourself. If you keep on biting and devouring each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other." There's no quicker way to bring destruction on yourself or your family or your organization than to begin to function as fleshly human beings. So he says, live by the Spirit. Now I'm going to read this wrongly, verse 16, because I think it's the way that many of us understand what this is saying. So I say, live by the Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, and you will not gratify, but many of us understand, you will not experience the desires of the sinful nature. Doesn't say that. If you walk in the Spirit, you will still experience the desires, but you will not gratify them. You won't let them rule you and control you. For the sinful nature, that condition you inherited from the fall, desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other. You have an internal battle that goes on as you walk the Christian path that you always have to be ready to deal with it. Now, praise God that as we mature and grow in grace, it's not as fierce as it might be at other times, but it's still there. And so we're to be very careful that we learn to walk in the Spirit. And then he says the acts of the sinful nature are obvious. To whom are they obvious? Well, hopefully to you and me, but the most important thing is they're obvious to God. God sees them. And here he lists them. Sexual immorality. Here's again the list of moral sins. Impurity and debauchery. That's an old English word which really describes what we're talking about when we refer to sexual addiction that's so much a part of the culture in which we live. And it's a very a powerful hold upon us. And then he talks about idolatry and witchcraft. Now those are spiritual sins. Those are sins that are sins directly against God, sins that that are an affront to the Lord. People who try to get in touch with spirits in order to learn secrets that they can pass on. They, of course, are sinning directly against the Lord. And then he talks some of the social sins, and these we're all more acquainted with. Hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage. Anger is a very much has its root in our flesh. And here he defines the extreme expression of anger, which are fits of rage and selfish ambition, wanting to put ourselves forward, dissensions, quarrels, factions, choosing up sides, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, who are those that are living like this? Well, worldlings or fleshly, even professing Christians, oftentimes fall into these traps, and that's the whole point of the passage. He's helping us to see that these have no place in the practice of the Christian's life before the Lord. And so we're to recognize the ways in which our flesh tempts us. Now, how do we overcome the flesh? And I'm so glad you asked, because that's such an important question. Remember, we already spoke to that, how that Paul says we're not to gratify, not to walk in the control of our flesh. Well, how do you overcome it? Well, if you don't learn this next points, and more than just learn them, put them into practice, I'm going to flunk you. Because they're just so important. And by the way, those of you who are parents, it's so important for you to teach this to your children. I had the experience of doing that with one of my granddaughters. She's a very beautiful girl, but from the time she was, I suppose, 8 or 9, her parents began to notice, in fact, all of us noticed, that she could just quickly fly into a rage. And of course, her parents were doing everything they knew to do to try to help her see that was not the way for a Christian girl to live. And she seemed to be trying to do something about it, but wasn't making much success. And I just felt burdened to kind of relate to her. And she had a practice whenever we went there to visit. She would, if I were seated on the couch, it wasn't long until she would be there by my side, sort of tucking herself under my arm. And so we had a close bond. And one day when we were alone, I just asked her, I said, "Honey, I can't help but notice, and others have noticed, and you know, that you really have a struggle with anger, don't you?" And tears started to come, and I said, "Well, I'm not criticizing you, honey. I'm here to help you. I want to help you know what to do. And so I'm going to teach you now what I taught her. And let me just say, the next time I was with that granddaughter, she sought me out, and once again with a big smile, but some tears too, she said, 'Grandpa, I want to thank you for teaching me that. I've been using it, and it's just amazing how I'm getting free of this rage that would come upon me.'" And I hope that whets your appetite, because you need to teach this to your children, because they have fleshly sins they have to deal with. And somebody needs to take time to really teach them what to do. Well, you'll notice we have this on C22. First of all, it's the walk of honesty. And this Galatians 5 passage, where Paul lists these sins, and the Colossians 3, and the Mark chapter 7, and Matthew chapter 15, speaks about the sins of the flesh, and how they kind of express their attempt to rule us. And so it's very, very important to understand how your flesh is working on you. And of course, anger appears in all of the lists, I think, in its various stages and effects. And so I'm going to use that as, say, the temptation, the besetting sin in this fleshly area that might be controlling your life. Maybe it's lust, maybe it's something else. But what do you do when that comes knocking at the door of your life? Well, the first thing is the walk of honesty. And that's just the ability to admit the truth. And I've suggested in your notes, Lord, my old wicked sin nature is tempting me to engage in the fleshly sin of anger. And I know it's wicked enough that if it has its way, I'm just going to fly into a tantrum or rage. And just admit that to God. That's rather simple and yet extremely profound in the spiritual walk that we have with God, just to be honest enough to deal with your own sin. The second step is the walk of death. That's the recognition that through the cross of Christ, you're dead to the rule of sin. You'll notice in Galatians 5, verse 24, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified. It's completed action. It's already done. When did you do that? Have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. I remember I used to think that meant that I had somehow prayed through in a particular time, and I just said, I put to death this temptation to be angry. No, that's not what it meant at all. It's your identification with the work of the cross. That's what happened on the cross. And so you just state that. Lord Jesus Christ, I affirm that I am dead with you to the rule and control of my flesh and this temptation to be angry. Now, again, that's very simple, but it's extremely profound to recognize how important the cross is. Have you ever noticed that the Christian walk, how so much of it has to do with keeping close to the cross? When you were saved, you had to come to the Lord Jesus, just claiming nothing but what happened on the cross, as that which could take your sin away and make you worthy before God. And for many of us, that was a moment of tears. I was only 8 years old when it happened in my life, but I just remember the tears that flowed out of my heart and out of my life as I realized what the cross meant and I received the Lord Jesus. But when you're baptized, you identify with the death and burial, resurrection of Christ. Every time you partake of communion, you're showing forth his what? His death until he comes. And one of the reasons I think the Lord left us to deal with our flesh is so we'd understand the importance of the cross, of the Lord Jesus. And just repeatedly, day in and day out. And there'll be many times in the day when you may have to just quickly go through these steps. Now, I grant you that you won't always be saying, now, what did Bubeck say that step one was? Or some other awkward moment, you will just that because you're united with Christ, that you are united with him in his death, and you've been honest, And now you claim his death. And the third step is to walk in the Spirit. You'll notice in verse 16 in Galatians 5, he says, "So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature." Live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires. Verse 18, "But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under law." Legalism will never free you from the rule of your flesh, but only the walk in the Spirit. Look at verse 25, where he says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law." And so it's a beautiful expression of the fact that in the Lord we have victory through the power of the Spirit indwelling us over our flesh. Now, how do you do that? Well, once again, it's your intimacy of recognizing that the presence of the Spirit of God is always there for you. And so as you're under the temptation, you've been honest, you've recognized the importance of the cross, now you just invite the Holy Spirit, who dwells within you, to replace that temptation with the fruit of his control. And I don't know how he does it, but it's remarkable how all of a sudden what was just seeming to be a steamroller to take you toward your besetting sin to collapse under the power of it, it just melts away. You don't know where it went, but you're no longer angry. You're no longer tempted. Now there's a fourth step that's important in this whole matter of dealing with your flesh. And that's what I call the walk of resistance, there on page C23. And let's turn to the fourth chapter of Ephesians, because it just says it so well. And I know you, some of this is repetitious. As you listen to the different presenters, you will hear the same emphasis from time to time. But you'll notice in verse 17, the Apostle Paul instructs these believers, "So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord." Notice how strong he makes it. He insists on it. And then he says that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do. In this context, the Gentiles would be the unsaved, those who are not born again in the futility of their thinking. What's their condition? They are darkened in their understanding. The second chapter of Ephesians tells us that powers of darkness actually control and rule them. Here he simply mentions they're darkened in their understanding, separated from the life of God. They do not have the reborn life as a part of who they are because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. They've resisted truth, and they have not come to know the Lord. Having lost all sensitivity, they've given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. That's the pattern of the rule of the flesh. Whether you're a non-believer, as he's talking about here, or a believer, as you give in to your flesh, it begins to rule you and control you. And until you begin to apply the victory God has provided, that will just go on. And you will be victimized by the rule and control of your flesh. Now notice verse 20. "You, however, did not come to know Christ that way." You didn't come to know Jesus Christ to be the victim of your own flesh. Surely you heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life, the way, the condition you were in before you were saved, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires. Now, according to what we've just studied, how do you do that? The walk of honesty and the walk of death. There's no other way. God has provided us to put it off, to overcome it, than through just admitting to God and to ourselves that, yes, that's ruling me. And the walk of death is to acknowledge that it's only through the cross that you'll be free from the control of that. And then you'll notice he goes on to say, to be made new, that's verse 23, made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Wow, that's wonderful. How does that come? By the walk in the Spirit. When the Holy Spirit begins to produce in you love and joy and peace and patience and gentleness, goodness, meekness, faithfulness, and self-control, you'll even surprise yourself at what begins to flow out of your life toward your family, toward others, toward God, because the fruit of the Spirit is beginning to be manifested. Now, let's go on. Verse 25, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood, which is, as we saw in Colossians, is one of the manifestations of the flesh. Speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we're all members of one body. And then here's where he gets very personal about this sin of anger. In your anger, do not sin. When you're tempted to be angry, is that a sin? No? Jesus was tempted in every way we are tempted. If you really blow your stack and just spew out resentments and bitterness, is that sin? By all means. It certainly is. And so, do not, he says, do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. Now, that's quite a statement. What is he getting at? I think it's in very simple terms. He's saying, deal with it immediately. Don't put it off. Right at the moment of the temptation, have a walk of honesty, a walk of death, walk in the Spirit, so that you will not, what? Do not give the devil a foothold. You see, if you or I allow fleshly sin to be ruling us, it's almost like opening the door to an unclean spirit of anger or an unclean spirit of lust who begins to take ownership of that temptation and dictate to you, you're going to be angry or you're going to watch pornography or whatever the area of defeat is. Demonic unclean spirit begins to want to rule you. Well, does that mean that we're demonized? Well, it can lead to a form of demonization, but as has already been stated, it's not ownership, it's not total control, because you were bought with a price. you belong to the Lord Jesus. But it does mean that you have to resist the devil in the union that you have with the Lord Jesus. And it's wonderful to do that. I think where, especially, say for example, you've been tempted by a long period of defeat in a particular fleshly sin. What are you going to do? Well, you're going to say, Lord, I just know that I've opened the door many times to the defeat of this sin of anger or whatever it is. And I realize that I have given place, opportunity. But I stand against any unclean spirit of anger. And I remember when I taught my young granddaughter to do that, it was such an eye-opener to her. And she began to do it with really very, very strong resistance. And God honors that. I was glad for the question. Who was it asked the question about whether or not we have the authority? Anyway, in that text, you remember that it says that even Michael the archangel didn't dare to bring an accusation against Satan. And he said, the Lord rebuke you. And there are those who build a great case on that, that if Michael the archangel didn't dare to resist the devil, who are we to think that we could stand against the devil? But you see, there's a great deal of difference between the position of angels and the position of redeemed, born-again Christians. You see, angels, even though they have very lofty position, the righteous ones, the holy ones, they do not have authority over Satan. Satan was one of the highest of the created angels. And so he had to say, the Lord rebuke you. But when you're united with the Lord Jesus, then you're not only can you do it, you're responsible to do it. And if you try to say, I don't have that authority, you're really, I think, insulting our Lord. Not purposefully, but that's what it amounts to. Well, I didn't cover the material. You have victory over Satan's kingdom that's set forth in your notes. Hope you look through them very carefully. And then, oh, by the way, on C30, you have quite an interesting diagram of the believer's position in Christ. And that's very helpful. His cross is my cross. His resurrection is my resurrection. His throne is my throne. His return, I'll return with him. His crown is my crown. Just so wonderful to know how intimate and how united we are with the Lord Jesus. Well, we'll bring this section to a close because it's getting to be time for our dinner. Anyway, it's just wonderful to be with you.